So we're Creativity by Design. We have a YouTube channel called Kaiju Okabe and Keenan.
So I'm with the Metrosphere. It's the student magazine over at Metropolitan State University of Denver.
Cool.
So we're so excited to hang out with you. So I guess the first question I really had was, you've played three diverse female characters. Ryoko from Kill la Kill, Haruka from Sailor Moon, and then Diane from Seven Deadly Sins.
Yep.
How did you enjoy the diversity between those three females?
I mean, I like any character that isn't just the stereotypical, like, cookie-cutter anime girl. So it's so nice that, I mean, Diane has her moments. Mm-hmm. Like, she's probably one of the closest characters I've played that's kind of, you know, stereotypical, like, jealous of, you know, the main girl who gets the affection of the main guy character that she actually likes and stuff like that. But, I mean, it's cool playing characters like that every once in a while.
Mm-hmm.
But I do like, again, playing, like, Ryuko and Haruka, who, you know, don't necessarily, their motivation isn't based off a guy.
Correct.
Or, like, being in a relationship. So I actually have a bunch of people who are like, who do you ship Ryuko with? And I'm like, not really anybody. She's kind of like her own thing, you know? She doesn't care about any of that stuff. It's the story is all about her, you know, getting her revenge and, like, other things happen. And, you know, she's just trying to figure out her way throughout the entire series. And then Haruka is just like, I don't care what anybody thinks of me.
I'm
cool as a cucumber.
She was such a badass character.
She's so cool,
I've always respected her just because she never fit that mold and did whatever she needed to do to still stay strong.
Yes, I totally agree. But yeah, it's very fun being able to play diverse characters. I really appreciate that as an actor because I feel like it helps me grow more and like helps me learn new things I can do or like helps me perfect other things that maybe I'm, you know, trying to get better at and stuff like that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So then, what's been your favorite role so far, just over the course of the past few years?
Oh, that one's hard. I like so many of my characters. I've been so lucky to play such a wide variety of just, you know, females, males, all different kind of personalities, different kinds of vocal ranges and stuff like that. I think right now, though, I was really excited about Tales of Berseria coming out, because the Tales of series was one of my favorite games when I was, you know, still just a fan. I really love Tales of the Abyss, and it's cool because my character Eleanor actually has a lot of callbacks to Tales of the Abyss. Like, her cameo costume is Natalia, which is really awesome, so I went ahead and I bought that DLC because I was so excited, and then she has, you know, some of the attack cries and stuff like that some of the other characters had as their moves for previous games. Yeah, so that's one of the ones I'm, like, super excited about right now. But it's really hard to pick just one because they're so great.
And you did just mention that you do play both male and female roles. Are there challenges that you run into just when you're kind of going back and forth between different roles like that?
Yeah, sometimes I'll do, like, you know, one character in a day that's a female and another character in the day that's a male. I feel like the only real challenge is because they're, when I'm playing boys, because they're young boys, sometimes they're a little bit more androgynous based off whatever the client wants as far as like the vocal tone and stuff like that. So it's a little hard to kind of make it believable that it's a boy to certain people's ears. Because a lot of it is like rasp, like usually the rasp kind of helps people like, oh, that's a boy. But some of the clients for characters like Gum and Hunter x Hunter, he's a little bit more pure, and he only gets that rasp when he's, like, in a fight or, like, getting a little bit more serious. But when he's, you know, talking normally and being really friendly with people, he'll get a little bit more clean in the voice. So it was a little bit of a struggle at the beginning, but I think I'm getting a little bit more used to it now that we're, 60 episodes in.
So obviously you've been in something as iconic as Sailor Moon now, but how is it to be an iconic video game character with Pac-Man?
That was actually one of my first, like, really big roles when I moved out to Los Angeles. So I still can't believe, like, I forget sometimes until people mention it, because it was really early on in my career especially. But, yeah, it's just, I mean, how many people, honestly, I think there's been, four other voices for Pac-Man just ever in any given, you know, game or show. And I'm glad I get to be one of them, you know. no matter how what people may have thought of the show or the game, because I wasn't, I did a voice match for the show that was done in Canada. So, I mean, I had a lot of fun with it. It's a very kiddie game. I don't know if you've played it. It's very, like, it's basically like Pac-Man platformer for the most part. And it's, I played the first one, and it was actually really cute, so I had a lot of fun with it.
So it sounds like you're a big gamer along with doing the voice acting for games. Outside of the Tales of, what's your other favorite series to do VO work for alongside possibly playing them?
As far as like, I play a lot of JRPGs, and I haven't, other than Tales, I haven't been in Disgaea. Mm-hmm. I was in Disgaea 5 as like a small maid character. But other than those two, and maybe Danganronpa, I think, which I had just recently got into when the first game got announced. But I haven't, other than that, I haven't really been in a series that I kind of actively played.
Okay.
But as far as like just games I like in general, like I love Persona. The Persona series is really good. Final Fantasy, I just beat Final Fantasy 15.
I'm almost there.
And 8 is actually my favorite, so I can play that one over and over again. As corny as it is, like the corny like high school romance trauma.
One of our friends' favorite is 8.
It's so I just really like it.
My favorite's 6.
Okay, yeah, I haven't played through that one yet. I still need to do that. I've played through 7, 8, 9, 10, 10, 2. I've played some of 11. I haven't played 13 yet. I watched my boyfriend beat 12 because I couldn't really get into that one. And then I play on and off. I play 14, and then I just beat 15. So I played
Nine's
a large
a
gamut
one.
Of it. 9 is so good. Yeah, it's probably my second favorite.
That's my second favorite, and it's such an underrated game because
yeah.
It came out after everyone was used to the big, more mature-looking
yeah.
designs, and even I wrote it off for about 10 years, and I found it playing like, man, why
yeah.
did I skip this? This is such a great game.
We played it again pretty recently, and it was, like, we had, well, obviously we had played it before, but it just rekindled, like, my and my boyfriend's love for the game because we just realized how good the game really is. And other than that, I've been playing Zelda Breath of the Wild, which is so good. It's so good. Like, Ocarina of Time was one of my favorite Zelda games. And then Breath of the Wild is just
yeah,
so
I'm waiting to get a Switch to play that.
I got one just to play. I know I could have got, because I have a Wii U, so I could have gotten it.
Well, that's the same with me, but I'm of the mindset, why am I going to buy a game on pretty much a dead console?
Yeah, that's
and
a
as
good
much
point.
As I love playing the stuff on my Wii U, it's just I don't find it economically feasible.
Yeah. The Switch is also just really cool. Like, I really like, I've never pre-ordered a console before, but I decided to do it with the Switch. So I'm going to get that. I already have Breath of the Wild, and then I just played that Snipperclips game.
Oh,
whatever,
I
which was actually
about,
pretty
yes.
fun. And then I'm looking forward to like Puyo Puyo Tetris because I love like puzzle games.
Oh,
and I didn't know until pretty recently that Puyo Puyo is actually they reskinned Puyo Puyo from Japan for Kirby's Avalanche, which was one of my favorite games as a kid. So it's like one of those like falling blocks, like kind of like Tetris, but just with like little gummy characters. It was super cute, so I'm excited about that.
So then, with voice acting for both video games and anime, do you have a preference, or do you just feel more of a knack in a certain area versus another?
I don't know. I feel like I have an easier time with anime just because I'm a more visual person, and I like being able to see the characters' faces, and like it helps. Sometimes the animation isn't like, because they're so fast with a lot of that stuff, sometimes the animation doesn't totally fit with what's going on in the scene, but most of the time it does, so it's really helpful to see what the character is emoting on their face as you're doing the line. It really depends on the project sometimes, though, because there definitely have been, like, maybe video game projects that I prefer more than certain anime projects and vice versa and stuff like that. Video games pay more, so that always helps. not that I necessarily do it for the money, I just have a lot of fun doing it, but when rent comes around, it definitely helps, for sure. Yeah.
Well, you've been doing voice acting for a few years now. Have you found that you think has been like the best time to get in, given that now you've got like all these series and games are coming out almost the same time as Japan's getting them?
Oh, I feel like it's actually more stressful for me. because when I started, it had just started transitioning to where, like, you know, things would have been out for a few months, and then they get dubbed, you know, months later, or, like, the next year or stuff like that. But we actually did Tales of Berseria before it was even out in Japan, and, like, there was barely any information out on it. And sometimes I like to go and research stuff, so if the information's not there, I can't, you know, do research on what the characters are like and stuff like that to kind of, I don't know, maybe I feel like it gives me a leg up on certain things because I'm a little bit more interested in it enough to go research beforehand. But yeah, it's been harder and harder to do that lately. And sometimes it's good, sometimes it's, you know, not so good. But it is nice to be able to play things sooner and watch things sooner.
Well, do you feel that you get to experience the characters more since you don't exactly know what's going to happen? Like, the Japanese are obviously, they're not going to know where their role's going to turn until it turns that way. Whereas now it's just that way same here. You don't know that that's going to happen until you experience it.
Yeah, I definitely think that's a good aspect of it. Because I actually, it's nice that you bring that up. Because I actually, when I say that I researched, like, there were shows, Kill la Kill and Maki, and some other shows that I did earlier on in particular that I did watch all the way through before we finished recording. But lately, I've kind of been skewing towards not watching the series, because, like, for Hunter x Hunter, I think I watched up to, like, episode 20, 30-something in Japanese before I stopped, because I was like, actually, I think I want to experience Gon's journey with Gon. So it's hard to say if it, like, helps or not specifically, because I don't know. It's hard to know, because even when I do watch a series beforehand, sometimes I feel like I misinterpret stuff, so then I have to be told the correct way by the client or the director. It's hard to know for sure, because a lot of people interpret things differently than other people, so I feel like that's come up a lot. But yeah, I think I kind of am skewing a little bit more towards not researching, just because, you know, sometimes I can't. So I'm just kind of making that just a thing that I do now. Unless I, like, really like something enough to want to just binge watch, or, you know, yeah.
I want to find the spoilers.
Exactly. So I'm not surprised.
Go ahead.
Okay. So just in general, what are some of the biggest challenges that you face through voice acting?
Kind of getting over myself really is kind of the biggest challenge, just because I grew up being, this is just kind of like my own just mental state, I think, but I grew up being very, I didn't have very much self-confidence, so I've definitely grown a lot since I started in the industry, because a lot of the early on stuff was like, you know, oh, I didn't book this audition, so I might not be good enough, or, you know, whatever, stuff like that. But then you just kind of realize that you're not getting it because you're not good enough. You just weren't right for the role, and that just happens sometimes, you know? So I've stopped getting down on myself for certain things. You know, maybe I won't get certain auditions for X, Y, Z reason, but I have to realize it's usually not just because of me. There's just other factors that maybe I don't know about sometimes, and I have to stop thinking so much about the negative and just kind of move forward. Because, I mean, I've been doing pretty well in my career, I'd like to say. I've been doing, comparatively to some other people, I've been doing well with how short of a time I have. Because I know other people that are amazing actors, but they just haven't gotten their foot in the door as fast as I was somehow able to. So it doesn't really matter about how good you are sometimes. It's just more of like being in the right place at the right time and making the right connections. And I think that kind of happened with me. And because that happened with me so fast, sometimes when, you know, maybe I don't work, like, you know, I don't work for an entire week, and that freaks me out sometimes. But I have to, like, learn it's not the end of it, you know. If it is, like, if I do have a dry spell, that just happens. That's a thing that happens to people. So, it's just a lot of patience. I've learned patience too. So, yeah, I think that's the most I got from it.
Well, it's hard to be driven, especially when you've come from that background of not having the confidence and building yourself up.
Yeah.
What type of rituals do you have when you start working on a new role outside of research? Do you do any kind of practice before you even go into the booth just to prep your voice or anything like that?
If I'm working on an anime, sometimes I like to pick a particular song that kind of resonates with the character or like just means something to me from the show. So for like Kill la Kill, a lot of it was like the don't lose your way, you know. So I listen to that a lot on the way to sessions and to kind of warm up my voice, I'd hum along or sing along with it. And for Sword Art Online, I think it was, I forget if it's the opening or the ending thing, but it's a song called Courage.
Mm-hmm.
And I listen to that a lot. And you know, it's usually more music based for me. So yeah.
That's an interesting trigger.
Yeah. It helps me get into characters.
I love that.
You put on the spot.
I know.
Yeah, go ahead. My brain's went.
So, in terms of recognition, what are some of the high and low points for that with you? Like, what's one of your best moments, and have you ever struggled with feeling like you're getting enough recognition for voice acting?
Oh, it's, I mean, kind of with the, well, I guess it doesn't really totally fall into the self-confidence thing, but I'm very introverted just in my personal life. I have times when I can be extroverted, so I guess I'm more of an ambivert, I learned the term pretty recently. So, but I lean more towards being introverted, so it's actually kind of hard sometimes for me to be put in the spotlight. Like, when I was younger, I had to do, like, this, what, like, 8th grade farewell speech or something like that, or, like, middle school farewell speech. And I was so scared of public speaking at that point that I stumbled through the entire speech, just shaking the entire way through. And when I was done, I immediately ran to the bathroom and just started crying. Like, that's how anxious I was about public speaking. I've gotten a lot better since then. Doing a lot of conventions has really helped me. So I feel like more of me going to conventions is me just promoting shows and having been a fan before. And I used to just go to conventions. Just for fun, and I'd meet voice actors and get autographs and sit on panels. So I feel like a lot of me going to conventions is me giving back for that. So it's less about recognition and me more feeling like, you know, I'm paying it forward to people that, you know, were fans like I was and want to get into voiceover, and just to kind of show that it's possible, like you can do it, you know. But other than that, like, I don't get offended when people don't know who I am, because, you know, a lot of people are like, oh my god, you did this character, and I'm like, yeah, that's me, I did that one. But it's not like I get recognized at the supermarket or anything. Every once in a while when I'm walking around, the dealer's hall and stuff like that, people will recognize me, but if they don't, I'm like, okay, that's fine, I get to shop in peace. Like, so, but I don't say, like, no to people that want pictures if they do happen to see me or if they want a quick autograph or something. It makes me feel good, but it's not something that I necessarily need to strive, because, you know, I do enjoy that people like my performances and like the characters that I play, and it means something to them. But I also kind of just do it for myself, because it helps. It's really helped me kind of get out of my shell and grow as a person and an actor. So recognition is like at the bottom of the totem pole of importance for.
So being that you were a fan, is that what inspired you to do this voice work, or was there something else that went with it?
Yeah, it was more of being a fan, because I've always loved cartoons and video games, and I started getting into anime like age 13 or so, and Final Fantasy X is actually kind of what spurred the whole, like, oh my gosh, like, this is cool, this is a thing people do. So it was just a lot of just being a big old dork, just looking it up. And you know, I started taking, I'm from Chicago, and I moved out to LA about five, 6 years ago, and I started taking voiceover classes at a certain point, because I had taken a few acting classes in school, and then I did a lot of, like, online stuff as a hobby when I was a teenager, and I just started taking classes when I moved out to LA, and I still take classes, because, you know, never too late to stop learning. even at, if you feel like you're at your highest level, which I don't. I feel like I have a lot to learn still. But yeah, I started taking classes and then just kind of got into it. Really, like, it's just right place at the right time kind of thing. So I was one of the lucky fans, because it doesn't happen for everybody.
It is a nice inspirational story, though, being a fan, seeing from both sides, because I think that's something that a lot of voice actors do miss at times, is they weren't able to see what fan kind of feels.
Yeah.
And do you think that makes you appreciate just the amount of success you have gotten? Just in general, from the light, a lot of the lead roles. I know it's a lot of being in the right place at the right time, but with that, I guess the better question is, what would you say to somebody as a fan, just like yourself, if they wanted to get into voice acting?
I'd just say, like, be yourself, maybe, like, a less, like, fangasm version of yourself, because there are definitely times when, you know, I'll meet people in the industry who I love certain performances of. Like, one of the very first jobs I did, I worked with Wendy Lee.
Oh, yeah.
And she's, you know, Faye and Cowboy Bebop and TK and Digimon, and I was, like, terrified working with her, and I didn't want to be like, oh my god, I loved you in the thing, you know? I think I saved it for the last session, before I was finally like, hey, you know, I actually, like, really love your work, and I really appreciate you, like, you know, because she was still teaching me, because I was still really new. She was teaching me about certain things and stuff like that, and I was like, I really appreciate this, like, this is really awesome. So you just have to be, like, know to put your professional mannerisms ahead of your fan mannerisms. But you can, it's still okay to be a fan.
Mm-hmm.
Just don't, like, you know, don't go into a thing with, like, you know, wearing all your anime gear or something like that. Because you still need to show that, you know, you can be a professional. But some companies do actually get excited when fans are in their stuff.
Oh, really?
So, yeah. It's becoming a little bit more common now, I think. But you still have to kind of rein it in a little bit.
Well, yeah.
Well, it's probably also because then you're putting your passion into it, because that's the thing you love.
They know that you're going to give your all for it, yeah. Sure.
But I think that's a really good point, kind of taking a step back and not fangasming at everything with, like, the deer in the headlights type look.
Yeah, because it can be intimidating sometimes because Tales of Berseria for me was like just, I had to kind of like breathe a lot of the time because I was just like so excited about being in it and just like so nervous that, you know, because anything can happen. You can go in for a role and they could have picked you and been like, oh my God, you're great. And maybe they go into a session with you and they're like, oh wait, you know, this isn't working out. And that's like, you know, soul crushing. It can't be soul crushing. So, it hasn't happened to me yet, luckily. But I can imagine just how awful that would be if you're super excited about something and then they decide it's not working for whatever reason. Like, it could be a multitude of reasons. But, so you kind of have to just, you know, remember to put that professional side first. Because, you know, I mean, you never know what can happen in the industry. And, like, some people, like I said, some people are, you know, very receptive towards it.
Mm-hmm.
But other people, it kind of turns people off sometimes, too. So you kind of have to, like, feel the room a little bit. And then maybe if you realize it's okay, then maybe show it a little bit at a time.
Okay.
And then, yeah.
Awesome.
That's been my experience, and I feel like it's worked out for me. But, yeah.
That's a good pointer to take on.
Yeah, for sure.
So, what are some of your goals in voice acting moving forward?
I'd love to get an agent, because as much as I love doing anime, it doesn't pay very much. So being able to, like, branch out and do a little bit more Western cartoons and commercials and, you know, maybe, like, stuff for, you know, feature movies and stuff like that would be really cool, I think. But I'd still love to do as much anime as possible if they'll, you know, they'll still have me in a few years. Yeah, that's probably the biggest thing. I actually just did something really cool that I can't talk about yet. That kind of, it feels like it's pushing me in that direction a little bit. So I'm making my way slowly but surely. Things are happening. I'm excited for the future. So.
Well, if there was any character in the world you could play, who would it be?
Oh gosh. Oh man. honestly love to be anything in like a Disney movie. And I know that's a little difficult because they tend to cast a lot of celebrities.
You can play Pac-Man in the next Wreck-It Ralph.
I mean, hey, if they use that version of Pac-Man, I was so upset because like a bunch of people were like, oh my god, I heard Pac-Man's going to be in Super Smash Brothers. Maybe you'll get to voice him. And it ended up being classic Pac-Man, who didn't have a voice. Yeah. So I was like, you know, that's fine. It's cool that he's in it anyway. But yeah, it wasn't my version of Pac-Man, so yeah, who knows. I think they used the classic version for Wreck-It Ralph too, so I don't know. But if it did, like, I'd be all over that. I think that'd be so cool, just being anything in a Disney movie. And, like, just background voices, just to see my name in the credits of, like, a feature film, I think would be really cool.
I guess, what advice would you give to aspiring voice actors? Like you said, some of it does come down to luck, but what else can they do to just really help establish themselves?
Yeah, just, Well, I feel like a lot of people come up to me and they're like, you know, I'm really shy. I don't know, like, how did you do it? You said you were a shy person. How did you get into it? And I honestly think you should just do it, you know, because you're never going to get over your shyness if you don't try. And that's what I did. I was so terrified of being on stage and being in front of people. But my senior year of college, I just went out and I auditioned for stuff. I didn't, you know, get huge things, but I got some stuff, and it got me that experience. And, so just, if it's something you really want to do, just kind of go out and do it, and maybe it'll start off slow, and, you know, you'll take your time getting to that point in your life to where you feel confident enough to be in front of people and speak, but, I mean, it's possible. I did it, so. I still get a little nervous sometimes, but I've actually noticed pretty recently that I've stopped getting nervous in front of working with because obviously you work with somebody enough, you're gonna get comfortable. But I recently noticed that I, even working with new people, like I feel totally fine. It took about 3 years, but it finally happened. So just be in it for the long run. Don't do anything, you know, halfway. Just go for it if it's something you really want to do.
I don't have any other questions. I just have to admittedly say you're awesome. I've always been a very extroverted person.
Okay.
So I've never understood the challenges for an introvert. I've always went up to anyone. There's no such thing as a stranger. So
he also thinks candy from strangers is the best.
Exactly.
It tastes better than regular
so
candy.
If for me, I don't know if you guys have any other questions. I just want to say I think it's brilliant that as an introvert that you've overcome those challenges and have proven to fans out there that it is possible to take that risk. You just have to have the dedication and the drive.
I mean, I definitely relapse sometimes for sure. Like after doing a bunch of panels in a row or autograph sessions, you know, meeting like a few dozen people at a time, I have to go back to my room and like kind of relax a little bit and recharge. But yeah, I mean, I just go out there later after recharging and smile on my face. I'm just happy to meet everybody. So I'm just, like, honestly, I'm just super grateful. So I think that kind of helps push me, too.
I'm pretty much good as well.
Yeah, I guess last thing I forgot to touch on was, who are some of your big inspirations?
Oh, gosh, so many. I mean, Steve and Mary are here. They were great. I love Cowboy Bebop. When I was younger, Tony Oliver, who's directed me on so many shows, he's been great. He's the person who really helped me get my foot in the door. Wendy Lee is great. Laura Bailey, Travis Willingham. Kate, I actually loved Caitlin's work, you know, way back when too. So it's really cool being friends with a lot of these people now, so, and doing conventions with them, and getting to like be their peer, but you know, subtly fangasming inside, sometimes outside too, which is really embarrassing, but yeah, I think there's probably way more I could name. Yeah, those are some of the few I could think of, yeah.
Anything you'd like to add yourself before?
I think we covered a lot.
I think so.
Alright, well, thank you so much.
Thank you.